Hello, my name is Jimmy, and this is the 2022 Hyundai Santa Fe Hybrid. Mentioned, this is the Santa Fe, which means it's kind of the middle of the entire Hyundai SUV lineup. You got the Venue, you got the Kona, you got the Tucson, you got this, then the Palisade. I guess it's not really in the middle, it's on the upper end. But this is their kind of five passenger SUV with a little bit more space than the Tucson. And the Tucson we had last week was quite good. So let's see what the Santa Fe has to offer. For 2021, the Santa Fe got a pretty big refresh. Styling was changed inside as well as out. But for 2022, basically minimal changes. You get the plug-in hybrid variant, as well as an urban edition in Canada or the XRT in the US, which is kind of like an off-road edition, but without any additional ground clearance, it really isn't that much of an off-road edition, just more of an appearance package. But we're here to talk about this, the luxury edition of the hybrid. At least here in Canada, in the US it's called the Limited, but it's basically the same thing. We get pretty good styling inside and out, I think, but let's talk about it on the front here first. We get distinctive T-shaped daytime running lights that go from the top here all the way down to the bottom where the low beam as well as the high beam is. It flanks this relatively large satin chrome grille. It's a pretty good looking vehicle up front here, and it's quite distinctive. But as we said a lot of times, Hyundai doesn't have its own look. I mean, if you look at Audis, BMWs, you can look at any of their range and it's very easy for anyone to say that that's a BMW, that's an Audi, that's a Volkswagen or whatever it may be. Hyundai doesn't really have a shape to them. If we look at it from the side, we do have 19-inch wheels. Because it's not the calligraphy edition, we have some of these black body cladding here, which is fine. The calligraphy, in my opinion, does make it look a lot better, especially in the press photos of that red and chrome. It is a very good color combination. We get some chrome window surrounds, a roof rack on the top, and if we compare the body on this to the Tucson that we have last week, this is definitely more old school Hyundai because, well, it's smooth. It doesn't have those jagged edge or body creases that the Tucson had. And then in the back, we get this beautiful taillight that just spans the entire width of the vehicle. And there's another one down below. But unfortunately, that's kind of fake because the light, well, it ends right here. Everything in the middle does not light up, and that's the same from the bottom, and that's kind of a shame because I'm a big sucker for full width light bars, and it gives me like 80% in terms of, well, maybe even 90% in terms of looks, but functionality, big fat zero. In any case, let's take a look inside the trunk here. Like many Hyundai and Kia products, just keep the key on you, stand behind the vehicle for a few seconds, and the trunk automatically opens up here. And it reveals 36.4 cubic feet of space. If you fold the rear seats down with a button that's on the side here, that goes to 72.1, and it really expands the amount that you can carry. The only thing is the Tucson actually had a little bit more space. It's kind of weird. But what we do have in here is a little bit of compartments underneath. The one closer to the back here, there honestly isn't too much. But the one that's a little bit further ahead, there's three large buckets in here. You can store a lot. And if you want a little bit more space, you can take the foam out and, well, you can put everything in there. It's a very, very large space. And that's because in other markets, this is a seven passenger vehicle. And that's exactly where the third row would be. So you actually get quite a bit underneath that you actually don't get with the Tucson. You get a little bit, but not as much as this. Let's go to those rear seats though. All right, back seat of the Santa Fe. If I sit upright at 5'11", I actually grazed the headliner just a little bit, so I had to slouch just a tad. In terms of headroom and legroom, it's actually a little bit less than the Tucson that I had last week. But you do get more width in here, so you can kind of, you know, actually spread your elbows out a little bit. there are shades on the side to keep your kiddos nice and, well, dark. But there's also heated seats, ventilation, as well as USB ports back here. This, while not being the calligraphy edition, which does get like the Nappa leather, I don't think this is too bad at all. You get your armrest, you get your integrated cup holders, you can lean back. It's decently comfortable. And if you need, you can move the seat forward as well. So if you are putting kiddos back here and you just want to have easier access to them, you can slide the seats fore and aft. And speaking of kiddos, if you're interested, I have a separate video linked up here where I install car seats. I have a Kleck Ling as well as a Kleck Fünf, which is a convertible, as well as an infant seat, just to show you exactly how much space there is inside this vehicle. I am a CPST, which is a child passenger safety technician, so I pass an exam to, well, install child seats safely in a vehicle. So yeah, go take a look at it if you're interested. If not, let's go to the front seats here and let's see what that's like. All right, the front seats of the Santa Fe, they're quite supportive. They're heated, they're cooled with buttons right here on the console. There's more than enough headroom, there's more than enough legroom. As said, this is wider than the Tucson, and you certainly feel that here. It's just, well, there's just more space. In front, pretty traditional Hyundai steering wheel, nothing to complain about. You do get paddle shifters on the back, and you also have a full digital cluster. The digital cluster is very similar to a lot of Hyundai vehicles. You actually get quite a bit, and depending on drive modes, you can switch how it looks, and you also can get this cube view, which isn't part of the drive modes, but I think that looks the best in my opinion. What is missing, because this is the luxury edition and not the calligraphy, is I don't have a 360 camera, which means I don't get the cameras that can see my blind spots. I still have like the light and the sensor and the beeping and whatnot, but I just don't get a camera view of it. I think that's okay though. No heads-up display neither, but I also have a more basic infotainment system. It is an 8-inch unit. Honestly, I have no problems with this unit at all. In some ways, I prefer it over the wider 10-inch unit, and that's mainly because I have wireless CarPlay in this. With the models with the wider screen, you don't get that as an option, only this. It does lack some more features, like it doesn't have all the different things that the 10 and 0.25-inch screen gets. It's okay, I think. You get what you need, but wireless CarPlay, I kind of prefer that over all the other little features. Down below, I do have dedicated buttons for my climate control. I do like that. Shifters here on the left, and I got all my drive modes on the right-hand side. It's actually a pretty awesome dial to switch your drive modes, but if you're brand new into this vehicle, you might reach for that for shifting or for the volume control because it's so prominent within the center console itself. But I don't think that's too much of a problem. In terms of wireless charger, well, you can actually slide your phone right in this little cubby here. Really like that. It holds your phone nice and tight, and of course with wireless Apple CarPlay, I don't have to look at my phone, don't have to worry, don't have to have cables. It's actually a really good placement for it. You got two cup holders and one's hidden if you don't need it. It's a sensible cabin. It feels a little bit bigger, and it is, compared to the Tucson. The Tucson with its kind of touchscreen buttons, like I said in that review, I'm okay with it. I don't mind it. But I know a lot of people like physical buttons, and if you do, it definitely is a worthwhile upgrade to the Santa Fe just because of that. In any case, let's go for a drive just to see how it feels. All right, on the road with the Santa Fe Hybrid. This is quite different than a lot of other hybrids out there because underneath the hood, it's a four cylinder. Now most hybrids out there are four cylinders, but what's special about this is it's mated with a turbocharger, which means the little 1.6, along with the turbo and the electrical motor, it actually delivers decent performance. 226 horsepower and 258 pound-feet of torque. But where it kind of comes in, that power, that's where, well, it's actually kind of surprising. You put it into sport mode or smart, and you just give it some throttle. Right off the line, you get that initial electrical torque, which is fantastic. And then the turbo kicks in and really pushes you back in your seat. It's actually a really good system. And to top it all off, instead of just a regular CVT transmission, this has a 6-speed automatic. Now you might be thinking 6-speed is kind of old-fashioned, and you're not wrong. I mean, most vehicles these days, they run with an 8 or 10-speed. But a 6-speed actually works decently well on here. I don't feel like it's hunting for any gears or anything like that. So in terms of power delivery anyways, it's really, really good. All that power goes to all four wheels thanks to the H-Track all-wheel drive system. It actually works pretty well. And I mean, you don't really sense like it needs anything else. It's just a really good driving vehicle. And if you do put it into sport mode, it tightens up that steering, maybe a little too much for some, but it definitely makes the steering a lot heavier. Some may like that, some may not. Personally, I leave it on eco or smart and I just let it do what it needs to do. Steering, I mean, in terms of feel, it's as much feel as you get in any regular car these days, basically none. But I mean, it's a family SUV. You're not really thinking of like accurate steering, precision braking on this. This isn't the type of vehicle for it. But probably what you are thinking is safety features, and Hyundai gives you everything within this vehicle. You have your radar guided cruise control, you have your blind spot monitoring. I mean, it's everything that you really need to keep you and your family safe. So the 2022 Santa Fe Hybrid, this is actually a really good vehicle. Overall, the package of it is excellent. Some may go towards a Tucson, as a Tucson, it's a little bit of a fresher styling, it's a little bit newer, and you get more features with it because it is actually a higher trim, although lower in terms of just the scale on the Hyundai system. But in my opinion, for most, the Tucson should fit most people's needs. It's priced lower and is a little bit more efficient. Alternatively, you can look at the upcoming Kia Sorento Hybrid. It's essentially a Santa Fe Hybrid, but just a little bit bigger, and there's a third row. But it can only carry one more due to the captain chairs on the second row. But of course, if you want something even bigger than that, you can get the Highlander or the Explorer Hybrid. I'll get the video linked up here. This is a good car. My wife was actually thinking about this versus the Tucson as our next kind of hybrid vehicle. And you can get a plug-in hybrid, which is just even better. I'm still not sure exactly which one I like more. The interior, my wife loves this because she loves the physical controls, but I don't mind it as much, and I like the exterior styling of the Tucson better. And I just think it's quirkier, cooler. But, you know, 10 years down the road, it may not look as good as this because just the styling is a little bit more restrained. In any case, thank you so much for watching. If you have any questions, leave them in the comment section down below, and I'll be sure to get back to you. Thanks, and have a great day.